I'm popping, y'all!
Let's go!
Hello once again, my chickadees. GameNChick is back once more with another review. Before we get started, I'd like to give a big shout out to the kind folks over at Bethesda for providing me with a review copy to make this review possible. Thank you very much. So now with that having been said, let's get spooky. Ghostwire Tokyo is an open-world action-adventure role-playing game that is developed by Tango Gameworks and published by Bethesda Softworks. After 3 years of waiting, the game has finally arrived! But is it the game that we're hoping it would be, or is it a case of Tango getting a little too ambitious for their own good? Only one way to find out, so let's go! Tokyo is overrun by deadly supernatural forces, perpetrated by a dangerous occultist, causing Tokyo's population to vanish in an instant. Ally with a powerful spectral entity on their quest for vengeance and master a powerful arsenal of abilities to unravel the dark truth behind the disappearance as you face the unknown. Can the madness be stopped, or is it far too late to save humanity? As stated before, Ghostwire Tokyo is an open-world action-adventure RPG game, but what I didn't tell you is just how dark and eerie the game setting actually is. Spooky, eerie, a little bit messed up. Yes, this describes not only Ghostwire in general, but the many works of the director Shinji Mikami as well. This is the darkest game he's worked on since Aladdin and the Goof Troop. I mean, Resident Evil and Evil Within. That's what I meant, guys. Knowing this right off the bat will set the tone for the rest of the game, due to every part of the core game itself, with its characters and gameplay mechanics directly tying into the theme of horror and the unknown. As you begin your game, you take the reins of a man named Akito, who is on his way to see his sick sister at a local hospital. Waking up from having been knocked out, Akito looks around to see everyone in the district of Shibuya gone, like they've just up and vanished. All that's left is their shoes and clothes. No sign of anyone's bodies. Maybe it's just me being weird, but the first thing I thought of when seeing this scene was, oh my god, Cell's in this game. He's back! But of course, no, this isn't Dragon Ball Z, so he definitely can't be in this. While trying to come to grips with what is going on around him, he hears a combative voice in his head and notices a strange black mist seeping from his hand and face. It is a spirit named KK. He has forcefully taken over Akito's body because he needs it as a vessel in order to stop a man named Hanya, who is the one causing all this mess. After some back and forth between the two not getting along and Akito beating himself up like he's Jim Carrey and Me, Myself, and Irene, they call a truce. They have the same goal, stop Hanya. With the truce made, KK lends Akito his power of the ethereal weaving. After this brief introduction of Akito and KK, Akito says he will only help KK if he gets to go to the hospital to make sure his sister is okay. Reluctantly, KK agrees, but before you can set on your way, a mysterious, thick white fog covers the surrounding area, wiping from existence anyone that it touches and engulfs. Emerging from the fog are supernatural beings known as visitors, beings that take and devour people's souls to bring them to the underworld. It is here where you start learning the game's overall mechanics, ones that you will use through the entirety of your 12 to 15 hour story campaign, 30 plus hours if you choose to complete all the side content this game has to offer, but more on that in a minute. As you're approached by Slenderman cosplayers who come to devour your soul. What? No, I was being serious. Well, more so in the Slenderman comparison, not the cosplayer's remark. These enemies literally have no face and wear a suit just like Slenderman. It's the most obvious comparison. When the Slendermen approach you, it's time to wield your ethereal weaving and take the fight to them. Using L2 to lock into an enemy for better accuracy, you can press or hold down R2 for quick shots in succession, or charge attacks that will do varied damage based off of which element you have equipped, with those elements being wind, water, fire. All we need now is earth and heart, and we can call Captain Planet to come deal with all this crap for us. But then again, there's a bunch of red and black demon goo all over the place, so he'd probably just cry like a pansy.
It's making me weak.
What a loser. But anyways, sounds rather basic, doesn't it? Well, I can assure you, it's anything but that. And a lot of the time when utilizing your ethereal weaving, you will be strategizing the proper way to use it in combat and the multiple ways that you can use it to your advantage when going against multiple foes. For example, should you be finding yourself getting overwhelmed by scissor-wielding crazy visitors, headless schoolgirls, Slenderman-looking copies, or even big tubby burly visitors, feel free to open up your skill tree. Opening up the skill tree will give you access to even more ways to upgrade and strengthen your already potent weaving, as well as your other secondary abilities, like improving the distance of your spectral vision, an ability that allows you to see hidden paths, follow ghosts to a destination, read the thoughts of silly doggos, or find items that specifically relate to your objective. But if you aren't here to level your spectral vision, sneak speed for better one-hit kill melees, HP restoration with core grabs, then feel free to upgrade the stats for ethereal weaving with upgrades that consist of faster attack speeds, bigger radius for impacts with using water and fire elements, piercing ammo to go through one or two enemies, and fire more than one shot at a time. All these will be key to your success going forward as you gain EXP and rank up your character. Man, this does not even begin to cover the rest of the mechanics in this game, but we'll have to save those for just a little bit longer so I can touch base more on the story. As you and KK arrive at the hospital, you notice everything is amiss. Even the hospital has been completely overrun by visitors. This is when the game gets even more creepy. Moving through the hospital in order to make it to your sister Mari's room, the atmosphere starts to set in. It's dark, barely any light is on, and you start getting weird hallucinations. The walls are shifting, the rooms and hallways change. Chairs that once blocked a hallway, now they changed in a blink of an eye. You even see Sephiroth at the end of a gloomy hallway on the outside of the door with fire burning. Pretty cool, I didn't know he was in this. Oh wait, that's not Sephiroth. That's just some little demon girl wanting to devour my soul. No, okay. Arriving in Mari's room, you see the masked man known as Hanya once again in your path. He tells you his plan is to use your sister for his overall goal. What goal? Why is he even doing this? You see, his goal is to bring back his dead wife and daughter by merging our world with the underworld and creating a brand new paradise. Having already sacrificed 100,000 souls, his goal is almost complete. As both Akito and KK get angry and go for the attack, other masked people appear and then lock Akito in chains, holding him captive. It's the Akatsuki. I'm a big fan. I wonder if I can guess which one is Itachi or Orochimaru. Okay, now it's not really them, but every time I see people in masks, it's all I can think of. While chained and after getting Yamcha'd through the stomach by Hanya's hand, you aren't dead, just knocked out. After you wake up in a flower bed and have a heart-to-heart talk with KK and ask him to save your sister, you go off and cleanse shrines and gates to unlock main story objectives. Use a phone booth like Bill and Ted to talk to Mr. Ed in order to transfer safe souls outside Hanya's barrier so they can be resurrected. No, not that Mr. Ed, he isn't a talking horse. Then proceed to head back to KK's house to find specific items he needs for your mission, and in the process finding an old case file called the Sewer Kit that tells about kids disappearing near manholes. Either the Ninja Turtles have gone nuts that their pizza took longer than 30 minutes, or Pennywise has come to Tokyo. But enough story for the moment. Let's get back into some more of the gameplay as we still have quite a bit to cover. No exaggeration here. As I was talking about earlier, your main forms of attack comes down to ethereal weaving, but that doesn't mean that there isn't other forms of attacking or defending. Should you get into a really frustrating fight versus multiple enemies, if you time a block with L1 at the right exact moment, you will be able to counter their attack and block it completely, negating any and all damage to you. But what if you're just some wuss and are too scared to do anything, like the stoop kid from Hey Arnold? Well, you big baby, they have you covered as well with sneak attacks. Sneaking behind enemies offers you a one-hit kill on nearly every enemy you encounter. And it can make for some pretty intense moments as you duck and hide behind cars, dressers, desks, trying not to make a single peep. Whether you're shooting enemies with weaving and revealing their core so that you may use an ethereal cord to rip it out of them for an instant kill, or getting up close and personal with a melee attack with R3 to push them away, you will always be rewarded with SP for your attacks. Mika, which is your currency for purchases and EXP to raise your synergy level. Synergy level? Huh. What's that, you ask? Well, I did tell you this was a role-playing game, so obviously you're going to have a level-up mechanic, you big silly. This is actually self-explanatory. Want to level up? Defeat enemies, complete side quests, and be victorious in your main scenario missions. See? Simple, huh? So, yeah, you say. So we know how to attack, know about blocking, sneaking, how to level up with synergy, how to level up our skill trees, learned about cleansing temples and absorbing their energy, some story of events unfolding, how to use spectral vision, but what about the open world? Holy crap, are you nuts? We were just getting to that, jeez. Okay. Again, like I stated previously, this game is an open world, and it's pretty vast with lots of fun stuff to do and some, non-fun things to do. As you explore this great-looking map with its Silent Hill-like atmosphere, you'll be able to take part in multiple events, or rather things to do in your time. Go and search for doggos or tanukis, and use your spectral vision on them to read their minds. Once you read their mind, if it's a good boy doggo, they will lead you to a side quest objective item, a Jizo statue to pray at, which raises your stats or digs you up money. However, should you find a tanuki, you will unlock a side quest to go find the rest of his friends. It's extremely silly and a bit absurd, but overall it's a pretty fun time. When you're not being silly and talking to dogs and deceased tanukis, you're able to pretty much go where you want. Well, within reason, that is. The further you go across the map, the more white mist fog you come across. Should you happen to wander into it, you will immediately start taking damage. And should you stay in it too long, you will die. Think of it like an out-of-bounds ring in a game like Fortnite, and then you have a rough idea of what this feels like. Dying from the fog is pretty embarrassing though, just like wiping out in Tomato Town. Other side objectives that you can do for EXP or Magatama to unlock different skills are to seek out visitors that are absorbing energy from trapped souls in magical floating boxes. This will set you on a time limit where you must defeat all enemies in the area before the souls are drained and sent to the underworld. You can also unlock shrines using Naruto hand signs by utilizing your right stick to mimic the direction on the screen. Pray at altars for special wishes of where to find more statues, refill SP and health, do side missions for floating kitties that give you side objectives to complete and will reward you with Mika, traverse the world easier using shrines for fast travel, and grappling Tengu birds in the sky while holding X to fly and glide through the skies above, and even punch a random exploding barrel like me and destroy the world. Huh? No, I'm joking. Sorta. Once you step back into the story after goofing off in the open world, you learn that one of KK's old friends, Rinko, now dead, is refusing to leave this world till she fulfills what's keeping her soul trapped, and that she wants to help you. Although, KK doesn't really trust her that much. Find and defeat the henchmen of Hanya, which results in some really awesome boss fights with a werewolf-looking monster, a weird-as-hell-looking dog lady that involves you playing hide-and-seek with her till you rip out cores from her tail, a gigantic acid-spitting spider, etc. Then, as you uncover more of Hanya's purification process that involves his own dead wife and daughter, you weirdly stumble upon thousands of visitors flying up from a hole in the ground using umbrellas. What? I mean, it's cool and all, but Mary Poppins did it better, just saying. The further you push, the more despair Akito goes through trying to save his sister. You ultimately learn you're too late. Hanya, at this point, has won. Using your sister as a vessel, he unleashes its power, summoning forth gigantic kaiju-like monsters who further rain destruction and death upon the world. Holy mother of crap! Someone call Godzilla! Now with Hanya taking your sister once more, both Akito and KK decide enough. It's time to end it, even if they die trying. Finally catching him and confronting him, you beat him in a decisive battle, which, if I'm going to be honest, was very underwhelming compared to the other bosses in the game. Just shoot masks on his back and sides a few times, pull out his cores, and that's it. Takes 5 minutes. Then, that's the ball game, folks. The ending is a great wrap-up, though, which I'll get into in a second, because you know what time it is. Yep, I gotta state what I didn't like about this title, because no game is perfect. While I've stated a ton of positive things about Ghostwire, it's not without its issues, some being bigger problems and others just being small ones, really. One of the first things I found that I didn't like were the trailing missions using spectral vision. In these missions, you use your vision to see where a spirit is heading, and you move at a snail pace over and over. It took some of the fun out of the game for me, as I'm not a fan of that mechanic in other games. When unlocking a new area on your map, you are able to unlock new objectives and special interest in that area. However, when they pop up on your map, they all come up one by one, and it takes forever. You can't move your cursor or exit out. You have to sit and wait for it to finish, with like 7 or 8 different unlocks. They really should have unlocked all at once. Another gripe is when forming hand signals to unlock souls or specific doors. It's not always completely accurate, and the right stick doesn't always register right away, causing you to fail and retry 2 or 3 times before it functions. Smaller gripe, I know, but it still annoyed me. Lastly, my final two gripes were my biggest ones. First one involving the in-game filler and padding that the game tends to do. Instead of just letting you go to the end level like you want, unfortunately, you're sent on an exhilarating quest to go find gas, oil, and a turbine wheel. Oh, how I jumped for joy. Woo. but the biggest gripe I had involved gameplay sections that had you playing solo without powers as Akito. These missions take place every time KK gets dragged out of your body, and it happens far too much. So much, in fact, that it starts to feel like it was done on purpose to make the game seem longer. It comes at the most abrupt times and completely ruins the pacing with minigames that involve you throwing knives at visitors to stop them from killing KK. I absolutely did not like these and verbally groaned when they occurred. Overall, at the end of the day, Ghostwire Tokyo is an extremely fun game, but also really spooky at the same time. Whether it's walking through dark hallways and seeing the shadows of visitors stalking you, enemies without heads and deformities rushing and screaming at you, abstract and shape-shifting walls that blurs the lines of what's real and what's fake, the atmosphere is 100% Shinji Mikami's vision, and I fell in love with the tone and theme of the game and its world. Sure, it isn't perfect with all of its pacing issues, boring solo levels, unresponsive barrier unlocks, tedious trailing missions, but with its addicting ethereal weaving combat, great and even terrifying enemy variety, dark and nightmare-like atmosphere, plethora of meaningful quests to do, tons of unlockable skills and awesome characters, Ghostwire Tokyo ultimately gives us a great story about life, death, loss, forgiveness, and acceptance. To me, when concentrating on its underlying themes that all come together at the end of the game, it makes for a story that was beautifully told. If you have a PS5 and PC, I cannot recommend this one enough, even with its downsides. It's fantastic. So with all this stuff having been said, my verdict is clear. GameNChick says bye now.
Hey everyone, thanks for watching. I really hope you enjoyed that review, and I look forward to bringing more to you in the coming future. For new people, feel free to hit that subscribe button and give this video a like or share. And for people already subscribed, make sure to hit that notification bell so that you do not miss out on any future content uploaded. Also, feel free to click on my other reviews linked above because they're kind of cool too. So, give them a look. Once again, thank you so much for watching, and I'll catch all you chickadees on the next one.